Before we get started, this week or last week we talked about Luke chapter 4, verses 16 through 21, talking about the anointing and talking about being witnesses. And I had given you the challenge of going out and speaking to people about what Jesus has done and just opening your lives up to be led by the Holy Spirit. And we have a testimony this morning we're going to start off with this morning because it excites me when I see God moving in lives. And amen. So when we're obedient and we listen to the Holy Spirit, you know, God will open those doors up. If we'll just yet be obedient and say, Lord, just use me. Just speak to me and lead me. So I'm going to ask Kay if she's going to stand right where she's at and just give a testimony and tell you about what Jesus did this week.
Well, I just was thankful for that message, of course, and very challenged. And so went about my week, but I was consciously thinking about what can I do, God? And it wasn't that really that holy. It was just, okay, I'm going through, had talked to the Lord in the morning, and I wasn't really expecting anything. But all of a sudden, the day started, and you know how you have your list of things you got to do. And an opportunity hit, and it was, usually the Lord speaks to you in little ways, but this time it was like a billboard came down and said, this is the moment, you know, and someone just shared a need. It was just something simple, and I didn't have anything great prepared. I just listened, but I also was able to just share what the Lord has done in my life, and we were able to, it just opened a whole new door, and now we're talking often in the week. It'll be ongoing. It'll be helping this person with the situation, but it was just, you know, that the Lord just opened that door, and it was way easier than I thought. And I'm just excited to see what can happen and who else is around and who else have I ignored or how often have I ignored that voice before. But thank you, Pastor.
Amen. Amen. Well, let's stand this morning in honor of the Lord, and let's just open in prayer before we get into worship. Father, we thank you for the opportunities that you're placing in front of us. The opportunity we have today to proclaim your word, to Lord, to look to see what the Holy Spirit wants to do in our lives today, what the word of God wants to do in our lives today. And Lord, we just declare today that we're going to lift your name high. Lord, we're going to take our eyes off of all the stuff that's around us. We're going to put our eyes upon you. We're going to proclaim your freedom. We're going to proclaim Jesus Christ because you are Lord over all. You are our Lord. Personally, you are our Lord. We have faith and trust in you, God. So we ask that you would have your way in our hearts, that you would open our eyes and our ears and our hearts that we can see and hear and understand what you want to say to us today. God, we thank you for loving us. We thank you for forgiving us. We thank you for showing us grace and mercy and giving us strength to do what we do every day. Now, Lord, be blessed today by our praise. Be blessed as we lift the name of Jesus high, that all men might be drawn unto you. And we ask it as a church in Jesus' name. And all of God's people said, amen. Pastor Jake, would you lead us?
All right, let's get ready to clap our hands.
Forever safe in the Savior's hand.
Beautiful Lord, wonderful Savior, I know for sure all of my days are held in your hand, crafted into your perfect plan. You gently
Sense the presence of your Holy Spirit in this place, touching lives, setting people free, healing, not only in this place, but online, God, that your presence goes forth. And Lord, where your word is declared, just as we talked about last week, Lord, captives are being set free. Prisoners are being set free. The blind are seeing. Lord, spiritually and physically, we know that, God, your word is making a difference. Your spirit is touching lives. And so we pray today, Father, continue to do the work that you want to do in our lives. Lord, as we stand here today, Lord, we give you those weights that are weighing upon us, Lord, those things that are causing anxiety in our lives, causing worry in our lives, causing grief in our lives. Father, you have come not to give us anxiety and fear, but to give us peace, to give us liberty. And we thank you that the liberty that you give us in Christ, that we are set free. And Lord, that we stand here today rejoicing because of your salvation, because of the blood of Jesus, because the work of the cross, in Jesus' name. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Let's sing that chorus again. We are standing.
We are standing on holy.
Amen. You can be seated this morning. Thank you, worship team. Thank you. You know, before we get into the word today, we're going to jump right into it pretty quickly here, but just want to make a few announcements. One, I want to thank you for your obedience, your love toward one another as we social distance and we meet in this place. And thank you for all that you're doing to protect one another and to protect yourselves. And I sent that message out earlier. We just need to keep in mind as we, yes, levels are coming down, and praise God that's happening. Pray that we continue to have less and less of people being affected by this COVID. And we just want to do our best to protect each other and keep each other's hearts in mind, in our lives in mind. Amen. So I thank you for that. You know, coming up, too, we have the men's retreat. And if you have any questions about that, be sure to speak to Pastor Wes. I know that we have rooms set aside for that coming up. We've got several things coming up this week. I know I'm headed, as soon as we get done here, I'm headed to Bismarck for a John Maxwell Conference for Leadership. And then next week on Saturday, I want to put this out there, but I put it out to our board and leadership team, but we have an alpha evangelism training thing that's going to be taking place because we're looking this year, hopefully, going to that. And doing Alpha, it's an evangelism type outreach. And there's a training that they're going to be having in Bismarck at Evangel on Saturday, this next Saturday, from 11 to 4, and they provide lunch. It's going to be a tremendous time of just training and helping us as we think about having spiritual conversations, even like Kay shared this morning. And her testimony this week, you know, when we are obedient and we open ourselves up to allow God to use us, he will use us. It's kind of like that illustration I used last week. You know, if we pray for rain, then you better carry an umbrella. And when we pray for God to use us evangelistically and to speak into other people's lives, we better be ready. Amen. And sometimes, you know, we're not ready. I know Kay said that, you know, I wasn't sure what to think, but you know what? It's okay. But that goes along with what I'm talking about, just being led by the Holy Spirit, allowing God to orchestrate those times in our life when we get to share a testimony about what Jesus has done in our life and who he is, amen? That it's all about just being real, because that's what people want. They want us to be real. They don't want us to be fake. And they want us to be more concerned about them than putting a notch in somebody's belt, because it's not about us. It's about Jesus. It's about Jesus impacting and affecting lives. Amen. So let's continue to do that. I want to release the kids. If there's any left that need to go out, we'll release them for Children's Church. We are going to continue on this week talking about Heaven Bound. And in fact, for the next, I'm going to give you a little bit of clue where we're going with this. And just a heads up, for those of you who are online and those of you who are in the sanctuary, there should be a notes that have been texted to you. If they're not, they haven't been texted to you, you can go onto our Facebook page. You can click on the link, and that will take you to the Dropbox, and we'll give you notes. You're going to need those notes today if you can follow along with them. If you've got a device, you can pull that up. But I want to continue talking about Heaven Bound. We're going to be talking about the baptism of the Holy Spirit today and maybe for the next 2 weeks. And the importance of that is this. When we look at the baptism of the Holy Spirit, the main reason that God talks about this is that we have power to be witnesses, okay? And I'm going to be real with you. You know, it's not so much about the tongues issue, although that's a sign of one of those things that God does in us to give us that witness of the baptism. So when we look at this, I'm not so much concerned about the tongues thing in the church itself as I'm concerned, and as we go through these next few weeks, I'm more concerned about the baptism of the Holy Spirit in our lives to lead us and guide us, to empower us, and for the time of prayer that we have, because in Jude 20, which we'll get to, not today, but in the next coming weeks, just talking about us praying in the power of the Holy Spirit, because when we pray in the power of the Holy Spirit, we pray, the Spirit prays within us things we don't even know to pray for. Areas where we don't even know that we need at that moment, when we pray in the Holy Spirit, he enables us and empowers us, and it's given for the strengthening of the body of Christ also, and we see that in Jude 20. But I'm going to walk through, because one of the things that I've talked to people about, and I've taken individuals and families through this, because, and myself, I was saved Southern Baptist, so the Southern Baptist most, and I won't say this all because we don't put anybody in a box anymore. When I was saved as a Southern Baptist, I was told, you know, that's from the pit of hell. And I'm just being straightforward. That is not for today. And, you know, as a young believer, I dug into the Word, because the more I studied, the more I dove into this, I was like, you know, that doesn't seem to line up with what the rest of the Word says. So, and as the more I studied, the more that God revealed to me things about this and the importance of it. And like I said, not so much about the issue of public worship, tongues in the public worship service, but the power of the Holy Spirit in our lives. So when we look at Acts chapter 1, verse 8, you know, talking about, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth, he talks about. So we're going to talk about that today, and I'm going to walk through the questions, because I know that there's a lot of misunderstanding, and I believe part of that misunderstanding comes because the enemy knows how powerful it is for us to receive that, to walk in that, to practice that in our lives. And so I believe he brings a lot of confusion to that. And I know that even God's word says in 1 Corinthians, you know, God's not a God of confusion, but of peace. And he wants you to have peace as you walk into that and ask for that and seek it. But number one thing is, we always seek Jesus more than anything else. We seek his face. We seek his power. Because the goal is that we can live our lives, that we can be that light that we've been talking about. We can be that salt of the earth that God is talking about. And that affects all of our life. Amen. So as we look at this, just talking about this, you know, I've really enjoyed this last couple of weeks talking about Heaven Bound, talking about being born again, talking about being led by the Holy Spirit, what that means, and the evidence that we can look at that Scripture gives us. in showing that, yes, we are being led by the Holy Spirit. I think that's so important, the days that we've lived in, as I've continued to say. But we are empowered by the Holy Spirit, even as we talked about last week. We are anointed and empowered to do what? To be witnesses, to go out and to set the captives free, to cause the blind to see, that God will use us as vessels to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ, to proclaim liberty, to proclaim freedom, to proclaim healing in every area of people's lives. God wants to do that in you and through us. So as we go into this today, there's five things. You'll see in the notes, five things, and it's not three. I like the three thing because it's simple, but that's why I gave you the notes too. Five things, five questions I'm going to answer today very specifically. And I'm going to fly through this, so if you can pull the notes up, do that. First of all, the question is, what is the baptism of the Holy Spirit? What is the baptism of the Holy Spirit? Secondly, when does the baptism of the Holy Spirit happen? Because sometimes people get confused when we first get saved. The Word tells us that we're sealed with the Holy Spirit. So immediately upon conversion, we have the Holy Spirit. He seals us. We talked about this even in Bible study this last week out of 1 Peter. And then thirdly, how is the baptism in the Holy Spirit different from receiving the Holy Spirit at conversion or being born again, like we just talked about? Fourth, how can we know that we are baptized in the Holy Spirit? And fifth, how do we know whether we really have the baptism of the Holy Spirit or whether it's just us? One of the things that concerns me so much these days, and I'm not this big guy on signs and stuff like that. But what I am, and I'm all about what Jesus says and what the Holy Spirit wants to do. But there's been so much excess and abuse in the church, I think that's why a lot of people pull away from this. We've seen that abuse. We've seen that excess. And I believe, again, that's the enemy trying to do things to confuse people and cause people not to seek after things like this. But I want to clear that up the best I can over these next few weeks. So as we walk through this, we're going to tackle it. We're going to walk through a lot of passages. And again, take your notes. I gave you superfluous notes to go in and look at through this week. Lots of stuff that we're not going to go into. You're going to see some charts on the screen and all that, and I'll explain that, but we're not going to go into all of that stuff because I cover every passage that talks about baptism in the Scripture, in this chart. But let's pray and let's dive into this today. Father, we thank you, first of all, for God, your work in us, that we're here today because we're hungry for you. We're here today because we love the fellowship of the body of Christ, and you tell us not to forsake that. We also want to say that, God, that we're so thankful that as we give to you, not only our gifts and our talents, our finances, Lord, that you continue to pour out your blessing upon us as the body of Christ so that we can do what you've called us to do. And we are so thankful for people who are faithful in giving to missions and to the work of the church. We pray that you continue to bless each one as we do tithe and we give in offerings. We give sacrificially at times. But today we also ask that, Lord, that you would touch our hearts, that you would lead us and guide us as we dig into the Word of God, your Word. And I pray that our eyes would be open, our ears would be open to hear and understand and see what it is that you want for us. And God, your Word has never been given to cause pressure on us, but we know that you want to encourage us, you want to convict us. And I pray that, Lord, where that needs to happen in all of our lives, including myself today, that you would do that. But God, that we would see truth and we would walk in that, and especially in these days that we live in, that you would help us. Now, so we ask that you would bless us with your Word, bless us with your Spirit, and we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, we're going to dive right in today, and I want to, first question, what is the baptism of the Holy Spirit? You're going to see in Acts 1:8, as we've already read, that it says, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. Now, we know as he was speaking in Acts here, he was talking very specifically at the end of, after everything was done, and he had come and lived his life, he had come and given his life to die on the cross, to shed his blood, to be put into the tomb, to be resurrected on the third day, and to come out of there. And then he spends a short time here on this earth, then he is ascended to the right hand of the Father, where he is today interceding for you and I, interceding for the church. And out of that, he said that when I go, remember in John chapter 14, verses 16 and 17, he talks about the very fact that he would send the counselor, he would send the comforter, he would send the Holy Spirit. And so when that took place, he sent the Holy Spirit. And then in Acts, he talks about this statement in 1:8, and he talks about the power, and literally that word is dunamis, which means dynamite. That's where we get the word dynamite. So he sends the Holy Spirit in power so that we would be empowered to do what God has called us to do, and that's to be witnesses to the very ends of the earth. So when we look at what is the baptism of the Holy Spirit, the scripture defines the baptism of the Holy Spirit as this endowment or to endow or to provide to us with a quality or ability of power for service. Now, when we look at this, one of the things, and we're going to talk about this probably a few times through this, depending on how the Holy Spirit leads, but one of the things that we know that is so important, and sometimes people skip over, and even in the New Testament times, we saw Paul dealing with this in 1 Corinthians. We get so focused on the sign gifts, the prophecy, the tongues, and so forth, that we forget about what it is to walk in the fruit of the Spirit. And that the Holy Spirit does something in our life that affects our character, our personality, what we used to do, how we used to think. And in Galatians 5, it talks about that. The first thing it really needs to do is do that. Because what is it like for us to stand and speak in tongues and prophesy and all these things and not love and not to live the life Christ has called us to live? And Paul deals with that. So remember this, that when we talk about being empowered, it is to be witnesses, but witnesses is not just speaking. Witnesses is not just doing those things that are sign things. Witnesses is every day of life, every moment of life, whether you're with somebody or without, you're living that life for Christ. That in our mind and our hearts, that we're thinking about things that God would have us to be thinking about, and not like what he talks about in Genesis and when he caused the flood to come, and he said every thought that man thinks is sinful. That we are full of the Holy Spirit, thinking on those godly things. So when we talk about this, we clearly see the power of the Holy Spirit is given so that we can be witnesses that God wants us to be. Now, secondly, when does the baptism of the Holy Spirit happen? And I want to jump on this. This is something we're getting back into. The weekly memory verse is going to be Acts chapter 1, verse 8. You should have also gotten the text in your email or whatever, for that too, that'll be out in front of us. But we're going to focus on Acts 1:8 this week for a memory verse. So I would encourage you to do that, to memorize that. But the second question, when does the baptism of the Holy Spirit happen? There are three baptisms, and this is where we're going to get into some stuff and just spend a short time here. There are three baptisms that are talked about in Scripture. And if you're pulling the notes up, at the very end of the notes, there's a table, number one, that's going to look something like this, and this, and this, but it's longer than that. I've given you a few examples, but what this does for you, and it's just for those of you who really want to dig in and look at this, there are three basic, or two actual words that are used when we talk about baptism. The Greek word baptizo, and the Greek word baptisseme, okay? And then there's a third phrase there that's used that's baptizo ha baptisseme. And that means baptize the, okay? Ha is the. But what this is showing is throughout the scripture, we see that there's baptizing agents. And that's what you're going to see on the far right. We see baptisms that are done by man. Like when John the Baptist came on the scene, John the Baptist baptism was for the forgiveness or for repentance and the forgiveness of sins. It's what we call water baptism today, okay? So we see this water baptism. The second one is the baptism into the name of the Lord Jesus for the forgiveness of sins, water baptism. Basically the same thing, but we see some different things going on here within the passages. And then the third thing is the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And you see some of these already on here. You see water baptism by man. You see the baptism of the Holy Spirit, which is done by Jesus. There's a baptism with fire. Again, the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And we walk through all of these things. And you'll see off to the left, and you'll see on the legend up above, these are all one specific word, baptizo. And then it shows the event. But then also we see the yellow is talking about, or the orange is supposed to be. It shows up on your yellow. But the orange is supposed to be that one phrase. There's only one verse that talks about that. And then finally, the last one, Matthew 3:7, is that word baptisme or baptizo. And so you can dig into that as far as you want to go to understand some of the things that we're talking about. But he brings us up to show the difference between the water baptism that we're talking about and the baptism of the Holy Spirit, because there is a difference. And it's very clear in Scripture when we dig into that. So, and I'm not going to spend a lot of time there, but I wanted to provide that for those of you who may have questions about that, because I know that we have all come, like I said, I was saved Southern Baptist, so I was taught that that wasn't even right. And I know that now some Southern Baptists very much believe all of that. I went to one of those churches in Germany that was a, we call them Bapticostals. And they believed in the Holy Spirit, the moving of the Holy Spirit. They spoke and prayed in tongues. And they believed, they still had some Baptist beliefs too that was in there, but they also believed in Pentecost. So when we look at this, you know, when we look at the whole of Scripture, we see the similarity that takes place between John's baptism and the baptism in the name of the Lord Jesus, which I said are very much the same. But concerning the baptism of or in the Holy Spirit, we see individuals that are being baptized in the Holy Spirit even before they were baptized in water or in the name of Jesus. And such thing as, like in Acts chapter 10, verse 44 through 48, it says, while Peter was still speaking these words, the Holy Spirit came on all who heard the message. And then the circumcised believers who had come with Peter were astonished that the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out even on the Gentiles, for they heard them speaking in tongues and praising God. Then Peter said in verse 47, can anyone keep these people from being baptized with water? They have received the Holy Spirit just as we have. So he ordered that they be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Then they asked Peter to stay with them for a few days. So we see some different patterns throughout Scripture that, yes, some people got saved. They were baptized in the Holy Spirit the moment they got saved, even before they were baptized in water. So remember, what does it mean to be baptized in water? It is an outward sign of what is taking place on the inside of us. That inward work of us accepting Christ, repenting, confessing our sins, and turning our life over to Jesus. Amen? So when we get water baptized, it's an outward sign of what's taking place on the inside of us. But when we talk about the baptism of the Holy Spirit, it's a whole nother thing. It can also happen right at conversion or even after conversion. But the thing that we know is this. You must be saved, of course, to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. Because a faith in Jesus Christ, confession of sin, repentance, is key to us coming into that relationship, which is a no-brainer. We all know that. But just reminding us of how this happens. So when we look at this third thing now, we're going to fly through some of this. The third is, how is the baptism of the Holy Spirit different from receiving the Holy Spirit at conversion or being born again? Now, besides what we saw, the differences already, in John chapter 20, verses 22, he says this. This is Jesus. Jesus breathed on his disciples after his resurrection and said, receive the Holy Spirit. And at this point, we really enter into this whole new era. Just going into that a little bit. When we look at the Old Covenant, the Old Testament, moving into the New Covenant, the New Testament, we see throughout the Old Testament how that the Holy Spirit would come upon people. You see that specifically in David's life. You see it in the Old Testament when we talk about the putting together of the tabernacle and how that God anointed or he came upon people and gave them gifts and talents and abilities to do the things they needed to do, even to put the tabernacle together. And so we see this coming upon the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit would come upon different people to play music and to encourage and to be used by God in certain ways. But in the New Testament, we take a whole different step. It's not the Holy Spirit coming on somebody so much as it is the Holy Spirit filling somebody, coming into us. Because the difference between the two, and you know this, is the fact that before the cross, Jesus couldn't come inside of us because we were not, you know, the sacrifice hadn't taken place. So we were still blemished by sin. But when the cross came on the scene and the work that Jesus did, he took care of that. That's why he said, you know, it is finished. That's when we know that the curtain between the outside court and the Holy of Holies, where the tabernacle, the Ark of the Covenant, where God's presence was, they could all of a sudden enter in because of that curtain being ripped. Now, we don't need a priest to go in, and this is a word to Catholics, if you're listening. We don't need a priest to go to the Lord for us and to pray for us. We, as believers, there's a whole new priestly order that is done because of what Jesus Christ did for us. So now we can enter in, we can go straight to Jesus, we can talk to him because of the work of the cross, because the blood of Jesus that he shed is unlike the blood of the bulls and the rams. What he has done is once and for all done completely. It's not an appeasement as it was in the Old Testament. It is a completed work through the work of what Jesus did. So there's a difference between the Old and the New Testament in that way. So when he talks about breathing on the disciples, he's saying receive the Holy Spirit. Now, he's talking about not coming upon. He's talking about us being filled with the Holy Spirit. Okay? Now in Ephesians chapter 1, verses 13 and 14, we read this. And you also were included in Christ when you heard the word of truth, which is important, the gospel of your salvation. Having believed, you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit. Now, to clarify, this is at the point of hearing the gospel, hearing the word, the gospel of our salvation, believing that word, the message about Jesus Christ. At that moment, we are marked with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit. So at that moment, he says, he is a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possession to the praise of his glory. So we know the moment we accept Jesus, confess and repent, that the Holy Spirit comes inside of us and seals us with this mark of the Holy Spirit. Now in Ephesians 1, 13, 14, we see that mark, we see that seal, we see that promised Holy Spirit, that deposit guaranteeing our adherence, the Spirit of God which gives to us and which Jesus gave the disciples even after the resurrection. What that does is accomplish this regeneration work that's going on in us, that sanctifying work that we're being set apart, that we're becoming more and more like Jesus Christ every day. Now, I want to jump from that to Galatians chapter 5. In 16 through 26, we talk about this evidence of the Holy Spirit working in us, something we've been talking about, this evidence. When we read Galatians 5, 16 through 26, it says, so I say, live by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the sinful nature. But the sinful nature desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the sinful nature. They are in conflict with each other. So that you do not do what you want, but if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. The acts of the sinful nature are obvious: sexual immorality, impurity, debauchery, idolatry and witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions, and envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. I warn you, as I did before, that those who are live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. Now this today, brothers and sisters, is in the face of what is going on in our world right now. What we've been seeing this for some time, where right is called wrong and wrong is called right. But the Scripture, as our basis for truth, our foundation, our baseline, tells us what truth is. It tells us what it is to live a holy life. And he gives us a list that is really in disobedience to God's word. And he goes on in verse 22, the positive part of this. But the fruit of the Spirit is this: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the sinful nature with its passions and desires. So when the Holy Spirit comes inside of us, he begins to change our hearts, as we know. It changes our desires, change our passions, and really refines them and pulls them, narrows them in so that we're becoming more like Christ every day with those desires and passions. And then verse 25 says, since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. We've been talking a lot about that. Having wisdom and discernment, being led by the Holy Spirit. Let us not become conceited, provoking and envying each other, which again is the work of the Holy Spirit inside of us, because it leads us to love. It leads us to gentleness and kindness and all these things. So we see that, you know, that mark, that deposit of the Holy Spirit is doing the regenerating work that needs to happen for us to become like Christ. And that's why he gives him to us as soon as we confess and we repent and we ask him to be the Lord of our life. But the baptism of the Holy Spirit, as we go into this, it's another whole nother thing. It's a whole nother filling that God wants to do in us as an empowerment to be witnesses. That's where the separation takes place. Now, number four, the question number four is, how can we know that we are baptized in the Holy Spirit? Now, the simple and easy answer is this. Things have not changed. What the Word of God says is true, just as true then as it is now. Just as true today as it was then. So we look for the same things that the New Testament talked about. It hasn't changed. Our culture has changed. The world has changed in how we live. But the Word of God stands true. So we should look for that same evidence as they did in the New Testament. There is no difference. How could they tell in the New Testament when someone was filled or baptized in the Holy Spirit? So let's look at the scriptural evidence. When we look at Acts chapter 2, I'm going to work through these five different passages. When we look at Acts chapter 2, it says, all of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. There was something that was very visible, even audible in this place. In Acts 2, 1 through 4, again, it was the day of Pentecost, specifically we're talking about in verse 3 and 4. And we see that tongues of fire came down and rested on each of them as they began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. But those two things that are mentioned here that are very verifiable, are the tongues as the Spirit enabled them, the tongues of fire that separated and came to rest upon them, and secondly, they heard them begin to speak in tongues. So we see both the visible and we see the audible. That's why there was no question that something significant had taken place. It was not, as I've talked about in the past, you know, it wasn't subjective, it was very objective. It wasn't left to our feelings and our emotions of what was taking place. This was something that they could see and they could hear as evidence. Now, when we jump to Acts chapter 8, verses 14 through 18, it says, when the apostles in Jerusalem heard that Samaria had accepted the word of God, they sent Peter and John to them. And when they arrived, they prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Spirit. Now, here you've got people that are already believers. So the first thing that tells you is they're already believers, so what does that mean? They're already sealed with the Holy Spirit. They've already been given that. But as we look at this further, he said, they sent Peter and John to them, and when they arrived, they prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit had not come upon any of them. They had simply been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then Peter and John placed their hands on them, and they received the Holy Spirit. Now, in 18, it says, when Simon saw that the Spirit was given at the laying on of the apostles' hands, he offered them money. Now, one of the things it doesn't say here is it doesn't say specifically what it was, but it was definitely something that was, again, objective. that either he could see, he could hear. It was in front of him. There was not a question. It doesn't specifically say whether they spoke in tongues, whether they prophesied, what it was they did, but there was something that he saw that caused him to react and say, I want that. Now, his wanting that was out of the flesh, because knowing who he was, he wanted something that he could make money with. And he's confronted with that later. But the point was, the point that we look at, is it was something objective, something seen, something heard. Then we jump to Acts chapter 10. Acts chapter 10, verses 44 through 48. It says, while Peter was still speaking these words, the Holy Spirit came on all who heard the message. The circumcised believers who had come with Peter, astonished that the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out on even the Gentiles. Now, here you've got a bunch of Jews, the chosen people of Israel, that are thinking, you know what? The Gentiles, they shouldn't be getting this. But they're surprised because it's being poured out on the Gentiles. For they heard them speaking in tongues and praising God. Something very visible, something audible that they could hear, something very objective, not subjective. Then Peter said in verse 47, can anyone keep these people from being baptized with water? They have received the Holy Spirit just as we have. So he ordered that they be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Then they asked Peter to stay with them for a few days. Now again, specifically in verse 46, we see the circumcised believers astonished that the gift was given, the gift of the Holy Spirit, poured out on the Gentiles. How do they know that? Visible, audible, something they saw, something they heard. Now, in verse 46, it tells us that they heard them speaking in tongues and praising God. And Peter also says that these Gentiles received the Holy Spirit just as, and these are key words, just as they had. So they had an experience that the way that they did, they said, they've received it just like we did. So there's this comparative statement that they can relate to because they had experienced the same thing, okay? So that's key for us. Then when we look at Acts chapter 11, verse 15 through 17, it says, and as I began to speak, the Holy Spirit came on them as they had come on us at the beginning. Then I remembered what the Lord has said, John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. And if God gave them the same gift as he gave us who believed in the Lord Jesus, who was I to think that I could oppose God? So here in Acts chapter 11, verses 15 through 17, specifically in verse 15, there's this direct reference to when Peter and the others with him had received the Holy Spirit. Same type of thing we just saw in Acts chapter 10. It's a comparative thing. They said, you know, it's happening to them just like it happened to us. So they see these similarities, this similarity to the experience they went through. The reference states that the Holy Spirit came on them as he, the Holy Spirit, had come on us at the beginning. So this comparative word gives us a clue to what is taking place. It's not, again, something subjective. It's something very objective. Acts 19, verses 4 through 7 says, Peter said John's baptism was a baptism of repentance, and he told the people to believe in the one coming after him, that is in Jesus. On hearing this, they were baptized into the name of the Lord Jesus. And when Paul placed his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came on them, and they spoke in tongues and prophesied. And there were about 12 in all, it says. So, specifically in verse 6, we see here the Holy Spirit coming on a group of 12 men in all. And again, we ask, how do we know that the Holy Spirit came on them? The evidence is external, it's visible, and it's audible. It's objective, it's not subjective. So the group of men spoke in tongues and prophesied. How do we know whether we really have the baptism now is the fifth question. So we walk through these evidences, very objective things, knowing that it should be no different today than it was in the time of the New Testament, because we're living still in the New Testament. Even though it's 1,000 or so years later, 2,000 years later, we still go back to the Word of God, the thing that he has spoken to us and shown us. So the fifth question is this: how do we know whether we really have the baptism of the Holy Spirit or whether it is just us? Because The question I have asked many times when it comes to this and praying for people to receive is, how do I know? Because, and I think a lot of that comes out of the point of the abuses that we have seen, the excesses that we have seen, the fleshly responses that we have seen. Because if you're like me, I want what's God. I don't want the things of this world. I don't want that thing that is very fleshly. I want what's truly God. And when we look at this next verse, this goes to show us that, see, when our heart is asking for something genuine and real, God protects us. Because when we look at Luke chapter 11, verse 9 through 13, and the context of this, you could say, well, is this context talking about this? But it is. He's talking about the Holy Spirit. He says, so I say to you, in verse 9, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. Now, we use this verse for a lot of things that are not in context. Not that the principle is not true, but when we look at the context of this passage, he is specifically talking about the gift of the Holy Spirit. So when he says, ask and it's going to be given to you, seek and you'll find, knock and the door will be opened to you, this is what he's talking about. He's saying, ask for it. Seek it. And you're going to find it. Knock. For everyone who asks, receive, and he who seeks, finds, and to him who knocks, the door will be opened. And in verse 11, he said, which of you, and he relates to us in an experiential way that relates to where we're at, which of you fathers, if your son asks for a fish, will give him a snake instead? Or if he asks for an egg, will give him a scorpion? If you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will the Father in heaven give you the Holy Spirit? Here he's talking, very pointed. What have we been talking about? This is directly related to the gift of the Holy Spirit. He says in 13, how much more will your Father in heaven give you the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? So, what is he doing? He's encouraging us to ask. He's encouraging us to seek. And he's encouraging us to knock. Now, there's so many things that are tied into this. One of the things that I often get asked, they said, well, if I ask, but it's not poured out on me, am I even saved? Yes, you're saved. It doesn't mean that you're not saved. The baptism of the Holy Spirit has nothing to do with you being saved or not. Okay? Your confession, your repentance of sin, you're asking the Lord to come and show you and be the Lord of your life is your salvation. The baptism of the Holy Spirit has nothing to do with that. Yes, we must be saved to be baptized, but we don't have to be baptized in the Holy Spirit to be saved. It's kind of like people saying, well, if I'm not water baptized, am I saved? You can be saved and not be water baptized. Are you with me? There's so many things that have been brought confusion into this that people don't understand. And as we walk through these passages, we've got to understand these things. So we've got to understand that, you know, what is the main key thing out of this? God wants us to have everything that he has to offer. He wants us to receive the Holy Spirit and the fullness of the baptism of the Holy Spirit also. Not just being sealed with it at salvation, but to be filled with the Holy Spirit. And that filling we see throughout Scripture is an ongoing thing. To be filled on a daily basis even. So, our knowing, first of all, has to come from faith and from trust. And the one that we've entrusted our lives to. And we must learn to trust his character and his heart's desire for our lives. Remember that passage. He doesn't wish that any should perish, that any should be lost, but that all should come to the saving knowledge of Christ. So, to be like him every day in our lives and to follow him and live for his glory. Now, the final note and thought before I go into any further is that we cannot base We cannot base something as truth off of our experience. And I know the question will come because people have asked me this. Well, aren't we basing this off experience? No. We look to some of these things, but it's not the foundation. The Word of God is always our foundation. You've heard me say this a million times. We always look back to the Word. We always compare our experiences, everything we see, we hear, we compare it, we take it back to the Word of God. Because that is our baseline for truth. Not the experience. Our experiences could mislead us. But what does the Word of God say? See, even the experiences that we referred to today, when they said, well, they received just as I did. They're not basing it off that. They're basing it off the Word of God and what He says that He would send and He would baptize in the Holy Spirit. So they were looking for the fulfillment of that. And then when they saw it, it's like, oh, that's what He was talking about. Even on the day of Pentecost, when all this happened and when the Holy Spirit fell and they began speaking in tongues and prophesying, what was the word that was said? This is what the prophet Joel was talking about. See, they knew what the word says, and then they said, this is what the prophet Joel was prophesying about when he said that the Holy Spirit would come. So they always look back to the word, and we have to do the same thing. So what I want to do is I want to ask you to begin to pray about this. As we're walking through this for these next couple weeks, and I want to answer questions. And if you have questions come to you during the week, call me, text me, ask me, because I'm going to go back to the Word of God, and I'm going to show you in the Word of God, okay? The one thing that you need to always look at, too, and every time that this happened, there's a bit of confusion when it talks about, you know, sometimes it'll say they spoke in tongues and they prophesied, and other times it doesn't say that they prophesied, it just said they spoke in tongues. So that's why, as the Assembly of God states, they say, well, the sign of tongues is always there. Prophecy isn't always there, but tongues is. And that's why we always go back to that. But again, one of the things that I want to just continue to propagate is this. It's not so much the tongues in the worship service as much as the baptism of the Holy Spirit in our lives to give us power to witness, to give us the power that we need to pray in the days that we're living in, for wisdom and discernment, for God to do a work in us to make us stronger, because that's what Jude 20 talks about. So that is the very important thing that's in this time right now. I'm not looking for next week somebody to stand up and give a message in tongues and then somebody to interpret, although that shows it's a sign to the church in many ways, and we'll get into some of that. It's a sign of the presence of God doing something. And we'll never doubt that or never ask that question about, okay, you know, is that really true? We're gonna judge it as the Word of God would tell us to do. Does it line up with the Word as a message comes forth? And we do that anyway. Even if it's not a message in tongues, if it's a message that's prophesied, or it's a message, a word of knowledge, any of those things, we always take it back to the Word of God and we say, how does that line up with the Word? Is it encouraging? Is it convicting? Does it line up? And not to be afraid to be used by God in this way, neither. So the thing I'm asking you today, look at the Word, take those notes, go through them. As I've always said, you take everything that I say and you check it with the Word. And make sure I'm telling you the truth, make sure I'm leading you down the right path, not leading you astray. And the other thing would be to start asking. If you're not baptized in the Holy Spirit, you don't pray in tongues, that you start asking and seeking and knocking and asking God to show you, to fill you, to help you, because we need the power of the Holy Spirit to be witnesses. Amen? So let's close in prayer. Father, I thank you today. God, you want us to have all that you have to offer. The endowment, the empowerment of your Holy Spirit to be witnesses. The power to go out, the boldness that we need to proclaim not only with our mouths, but even the boldness to live our lives as you would have us to live them. With the challenge that's coming forth, with everything that's going on in our world, the persecution, but we know this too, that your word tells us that if we are to live a godly life in Christ Jesus, we shall suffer persecution. But we know this, with the empowerment that you give us, with the boldness, the courage you give us by the Holy Spirit, that you will help us, even through times of persecution, to stand strong, to be faithful. And we know in our flesh, we're weak. We know in our flesh that there's things that would even bring fear and anxiety inside of us. But when we look at the scriptures, we see that because of your work in our lives through the Holy Spirit, through your work in the Word in our lives, that God, you're able to give us the boldness and the courage that we need to stand up, to be as Paul, and to say, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, because it is the power unto salvation, first to the Jew and then to the Gentile. You working in us gives us what we need to stand strong, gives us what we need to have wisdom and discernment, to be a witness, to speak into people's lives, to know when to say something and when not to say something. Because you give us warnings even throughout Scripture to say, you know what, do not throw your pearls under the swine, because they may turn and rend you. They may turn on you. So there's a time of wisdom and discernment when to say something and when not to. But we know that your Holy Spirit will lead us and guide us, as we've talked about for these last few weeks. You will speak into our lives. So I pray now in the name of Jesus, first of all, for people who may be listening today that are not saved, that do not have a personal relationship with Jesus. I pray, first of all, and never will we take our eyes off of Jesus, that you would help us to place our eyes upon Jesus as the author and the finisher of our faith, the one who paid the price ultimately for us. As we confess our sins and we repent and we turn from our wicked ways, that we turn and we look to you, we follow you. And secondly, that we would ask and we would seek and we would knock for the fullness of all that you want to pour into our lives, that we may experience what you want us to experience. Lord, and I pray in the name of Jesus, help us to know truth. Help us to walk in truth. And I pray that your face again would shine upon us, that your countenance would be lifted up to us, that your face would shine on us, that you would lead us in peace, that you would lead us in wisdom and understanding, that you would give us favor as we live our life in front of people. Give us favor to show people the light of Jesus. Open doors for us to do that, that we might have a testimony of your goodness and your grace and your forgiveness and your power. Bless your people today as we go from this place. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to say, if you're here today or you're online and you have a question about that, text me, call me. I'm here for prayer, for salvation. I'm here for prayer for the baptism of the Holy Spirit. It all starts with us asking and seeking, knocking. Amen. God bless you as you go today. Have an awesome and incredible week. God bless.